شعت شموس الهدي بالكلمات، فنارت الأفهام بالآيات. أسرج بنور العلم عقلا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. Among the important aspects that influence our life is the motive that drives us. Each voluntary action we commit from the moment we open our eyes in the morning and until we shut our eyes at midnight has a motive and a cause behind it. What is the nature of essence of these motives? These motives can be divided into two categories. The first type of motive are driven by the power of anger. The second type of motive is driven by the power of desire. It's likely that mostly voluntarily actions humans commit are driven by one of those two types of motives. The third type is the motive that driven by the power of illusion. The power of illusion is relative as there is no reality behind it. It's similar to the notion of ownership. The notion of ownership is symbolic as it's not something tangible which can be empirically observed. The notion of governance is also symbolic. Therefore, the motives behind seeking ownership and seeking authority are driven by the power of illusion. This was the third type of category of motives, according to an analysis outlined by the scholars of ethics and morals. The fourth type is the type of motives driven by the power of intellect. The fifth and last type of motive is the motive driven by the divine and the unseen powers, which originates from one being close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from one having a great relationship with Allah. Making a distinction between the last two types of motives, the intellect and the divine, in which can become quite difficult sometimes. It is not always clear. This is a very important matter. Let's give an example of an individual that has good morals and good attitude. He or she has a good attitude with people at home, with people at school, with people at work. What is the motive behind this good attitude? One's motive can be a hassle-free life. This individual has a good attitude because he or she does not want any problems and conflicts in life. There's this interesting hadith that states, "من ساء خلقه عذب نفسه." Whoever develops a bad attitude afflicts himself. The one who suffers from a bad attitude is the one having that bad attitude. He or she will be the first ones to suffer. Therefore, a person with a good attitude realizes that having a good attitude will offer him or her a peaceful mind. He or she believes that they will live a hassle-free life. Why would a man treat his wife well? Maybe it's for the sake of his social positions and reputation in society. If he would have a problem or a conflict with his wife, his reputation will be polluted. Obviously, the decision in treating your wife well is a good thing. It's good and it's peaceful to have a free life of hassle. However, would this person be able to ask Allah the Almighty for a reward and praise on the Day of Judgment for this motive? Allah could say to him that you wanted a life free of hassle and a peaceful life and you earned it. You earned what you wanted. What else would you ask from Almighty Allah? Hatim al-Ta'i, he had a wife who criticized him for his extreme generosity. Hatim would tell his wife that money comes and goes, but what remains from the money is the memories and the reputation. Meaning that people will remember his generosity and talk about it. If Hatim's motive behind his generosity was to have a good reputation in society, then would he deserve any reward from Allah? Whenever we commit an action, behind our action, we must find out what the motive behind the action is. And we should strive to make a motive behind every action to satisfy Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every action should be done purely for the sake of Allah. There are two hadith that is narrated in the book Safinat al-Bihar by Al-Muhaqqiq al-Qummi. The content of the hadith goes as following. The angels ascend to the sky carrying the deeds of a believer, and that deed would pass by the skies and barriers until the angels stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being pleased with the good deed. They would tell him, "Oh Allah, this servant had a good deed." Allah would reply to them, to those angels, and would say, "You are my guardians who watch over people. Yet you are not aware of the inner self. He did not seek me in his deed. This man or woman had a different motive. He or she's motive was to be praised by society." Then the hadith continues and Allah says, "May Allah curse be upon him or her." Then the angels would also say, "May Allah curse upon him or her as well." This is the first hadith. The second hadith is also narrated by the same source, Safinat al-Bihar. It is narrated from the Prophet. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, addresses a man would not become a full man of understanding until he views people as objects before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like camels, they do not form our basis of our actions and deeds. If someone is praised by people, he or she should not care about that. If someone is criticized by people, he or she should not care about that. Whether people understand why he does good deeds, those good deeds are dedicated for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People do not understand why he or she did such a thing. So you shouldn't be concerned about it. Imagine ants, crawling ants. They come to know that you've done a good deed or a good action. Would you care? Obviously not. If those ants don't know about your good deeds, would you be sad? Of course not. The man and woman who is fully understanding, who does not give worth to any people's statement and thoughts before Allah's statement and decrees. A believer only deals with Allah. Allah is his only concern. Imam Ali alayhi salam says to his two sons, Imam al-Hasan and Hussein, "Do and work for Allah's reward only." Meaning anything one does must be for the sake of Allah and receiving award and praise from Allah. It's narrated that a scholar has written a book and he made a tremendous effort in finishing that book. And authors acknowledge a relationship between them and their book. Once the author finished his book, before publishing that book, a man came and took the book from him to read, and he did not return it to him. The book remained with that person for a long time. After a while, the author of that book found his book being published by the name of the man who took the book away from him. Us as human beings, once we complete something or do something, we like to be praised by people. Some people like to be praised for what they did not do. Unfortunately, this is a very widespread phenomenon in society where someone says he was part of a specific project, yet he or she had no part in it whatsoever. One likes to be praised and complimented and acknowledged. If we build a mosque and then we realize that someone's name has been built on that mosque, how would we feel? Now back to the story. The scholar who found his book being published by a man who took the book from him, he went to that man's house and he knocked the door. The man came out and he told him that, "I wrote this book so that people can benefit from that book. And you have published that book. I have written a second volume. Take this second volume and publish it for me and put your name on it as well." Pay attention to this selfless act. This state represents nothing but Allah's content and reward. The holy verse of the Quran states, وَإِن تُخْفُوهَا وَتُؤْتُوهَا الْفُقَرَاءَ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. But if you conceal them and give them to the poor, it's better for you. One should try to conceal his deeds. His or her charity should be concealed. All those deeds would be kept for him with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us success and achieve this state. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala ali baytihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin.
نحن ينبغي علينا أن نحاول في كل عمل نقوم به أن نبحث في دافع ذلك العمل وفي باعث ذلك العمل ونحاول أن نجعل هذا العمل متمحضا لله سبحانه وتعالى.